Hello dear students, how are you? On today I am going to discuss fifth and last part of hearing under the heading of special sense. In today's lecture I am going to discuss theories of frequency discrimination of sound and some applied aspect. So let us begin this lecture. First of all, some auditory encodings. Now you should know the hearing range. Normal conversation is held at 60 decibels. This is the normal conversation range. Less than 10, it is like rustle. Sound more than 120 decibel causes discomfort, and anything louder than this causes pain and causes acute auditory damage. The takeoff sound of flight or aeroplane is almost equivalent to this, so it can cause auditory damage. So person who work at those places use some protective equipments. The ability to discriminate sound frequency above 2000 decreases with the age, which is called as presbycusis. But the normal or in the young people, the sound range is 20 to 20,000 hertz. It is the normal hearing frequencies. Here hertz is the unit of frequency and decibels is the unit of loudness or amplitude. Okay. So now theories of hearing, they are classified into two groups. According to first group, the analysis of sound frequency is the function of cerebral cortex, and second group suggesting that the frequency analysis is done in cochlea. Now firstly we are discussing the first group, which is saying that frequency analysis is done in the auditory cortex, not in the cochlea. So in this group, first theory was telephonic theory of Rutherford. According to this theory, cochlea play simple role of telephone transmitter. Means there is nothing more than this. It just receives, entire cochlea receives the information and transmit this via auditory nerve to the auditory cortex, and auditory cortex interpret the sound, or analysis takes place in auditory cortex. So the nerve fiber can transmit only to the maximum of 1000 impulses per second. This is a Rutherford theory. Now Wally theory. In 1949, Weaver postulated this theory. Wally means groups. According to this theory, it was suggested that sound frequencies below 2000. So this theory is basically for those frequencies which are less than 2000 hertz. So for those frequencies, coding depends on frequency of action potential. From auditory nerve fiber coming from cochlea. Frequency of action potential indicates intensity of sound rather than the frequency of sound itself. Whatever amount of frequency is determined by how many action potentials are reaching to the auditory cortex. This is the Wally theory. Now theories of second group, in which one primitive theory is the resonance theory of Helmholtz. According to this theory, Analysis of sound frequency is the function of cochlea, that is why it is in the second group. Like the keys of piano, when the sound a particular frequency is applied, the basilar fiber in particular portion of basilar membrane are stimulated, like the keys of piano, which are arranged in low frequency to high frequency manner. So like this, there is a specific key for a frequency. When sound is particular frequency is applied, a particular portion of basal membrane are stimulated. This is the resonance theory of Helmholtz. So next is the duplex theory. Actually, duplex theory is the it is a combination of place theory. It is a combination of place theory and Wally theory. Wally I have discussed. Place I am discussing right now. So in combination is called as duplex theory. So duplex theory contains Wally principle, as well as which is given for less than 2000 hertz frequency, and place theory or traveling wave theory, which is given by von Beckese. It is very well accepted theory, and nowadays it is accepted, given by von Beckese. Now, before going into this von Beckese theory, we should know the structural properties of basilar membrane. The basilar membrane has two important structural properties that determines the way it responds to sound. Number one, the membrane is wider at apex, and number two, the stiffness decreases from base to apex. Okay, so it is wider at apex. If you uncoiled the cochlea and seeing the basilar membrane, it is narrower at base and it is wider at apex. This is apex part and this is base part, where foot place of stapes is attached. This part, foot place of stapes is attached. This part is narrower and apex part is wider. And stiffness decreases. It means this part is more stiff. Okay, this part is more stiff in comparison to this part. This is comparatively less stiff or loose. So these are the two important structural properties of basilar membrane. See in this diagram also, the basal part and the, this is the basal part where foot place of stapes is attached. This is narrower and this part is wider. Okay, this part is apex where helicoderma is there. This is helicoderma. Thus, the base of basilar membrane is tuned for high frequencies. The base is tuned for high frequencies and apex is tuned for low frequencies. In addition to some enhancement of tuning comes from structure of inner hair cells themselves. You can add this important property also into that. That the cilias which are near to the base having shorter in length and they are stiffer, which makes them responsive to higher frequencies, which fiber? Those who are nearer to base. Now The fiber which are longer and less stiffer, they are present near apex. Near apex. So, the same. So, according to that, there is a, because of difference in the toughness, because of difference in the toughness and the length, there is decreased response. No, you cannot say that like that. It is the response of basilar membrane. At the base, it responds to high frequency. Means high frequency sounds will show maximum vibration at this place. And low frequency sound shows maximum vibration at this place. Low frequency. And high frequency shows maximum vibration at base. So, Von Picasso determined that the movement of endolymph make the basilar membrane bend near its base. Starting a wave that propagates towards the apex. In this, you are seeing that a wave is initiated because of movement of endolymph. Now, this wave is propagating. The wave travels up the basilar membrane and similar to the wave that runs along a rope if you hold one hand and give a snap. Similar snap, the wave is now traveling. It will vibrate basilar membrane. Now, how frequency is discriminated after this vibration? If the frequency is high, then it will vibrate maximum at base. If the frequency is low, it will vibrate maximum at apex. So, the frequency is higher, the stiffer base membrane will vibrate in a good deal. And low frequency sound generates waves that travels all the way up to the apex and vibrates maximum at apex. And intermediate frequencies are between apex and base. Intermediates are in between. So, this is the medium frequency, high frequency and low frequency. This is for high frequency at base. This is intermediate, medium frequency, and this is low frequency which do maximum vibration at apex. Same is seen in this diagram also. This is the high frequency showing maximum vibration at base, intermediate, and this is the low frequency sound, 100 hertz only, which shows vibration maximum at the apex of cochlea. So, this systemic organization of sound frequency within an auditory structure is called as tonotopy. It is called tonotopy or tonotropical mapping of frequency. Tonotropy is carried forward throughout the auditory pathway. This topographical mapping is carried throughout the or present throughout the auditory pathway till it reaches to auditory cortex, or even auditory cortex also there is tonotropically. This tonotropical arrangement is present. So, which frequency is coming at where, which place is easily judged by auditory cortex, because same pattern is also present over auditory cortex. You can see here the tonotropically present presentation in the cochlea. This is rounded cochlea. Earlier I have shown the uncoiled cochlea. This is the coiled one. So at the base, high frequency, at the apex, very low frequency. This is the apex part. Okay. And this is the tonotropic mapping of frequencies in auditory cortex. Okay, now the how the after frequency determination, how loudness is determined? This is our next problem. Now, let us begin. Determination of loudness. Loudness is determined in auditory system by three ways. First, as the sound becomes louder, the amplitude of vibration of basilar membrane and hair cell increases. The vibration increases. So, the hair cell excites and nerve endings, hair cell excites the nerve endings and give at more rapid rate. In the second, as the amplitude of vibration increases, it causes more and more hair cell into fringes and responding portion of basilar membrane to become stimulated, means incorporation of more and more hair cells, thus causing spatial summation, and then it transmits to many nerve, then rather going into few nerve. So more nerves, more cells will taken into action now, and more nerve fibers in a single nerve now came into action, and they transmits the impulses, and brain interpret that it is now sound is having more amplitude or loudness. The third determinants of that, the outer hair cells. It is the outer hair cells now. If it is massively loud, then outer hair cells also came into action and stimulate significantly, and brain interpret that the sound is loud. Okay. Now, the third and last part is the determination of direction. How the direction is determined. In my previous lecture, I have told you this is done basically in this entire auditory pathway. The superior olivary nucleus plays a very important role in the determination of direction. So, let us see how the direction is determined. First, we will take the horizontal determination of direction in a horizontal plane. In a horizontal plane, how the sound is determined. It is determined, of course, by superior olivary nucleus. The thing is that it determines the time lag between the entry of sound into ear and its entry into the opposite ear. How much time the sound is taken to enter into this ear and how much time sound takes to enter into this ear. If suppose this time is less, this time is more, it means the sound is coming from this direction. This is the determination of direction, and it is purely done by superior olivary nucleus. You can see here in this diagram, this is the sound source. See the distance. Distance is very less in this ear. This is our left ear and this is our right ear. Now the distance is more in this right ear. So firstly, this ear will get stimulated. The cochlea fires and give impulses. Impulses are traveled first cochlear nuclei and then goes to the superior olivary nucleus. It is medial superior olivary nucleus. So these impulses will reach very early to medial superior olivary nucleus, and these impulses will reach very late. So at their junction, brain will interpret that sound is coming very early, which reaches very early from left side, and sound reaches very late from right side. By this, the brain interpreted that sound is coming towards from the left ear. Now, vertical sound mapping. Vertical sound mapping is purely determined by, or you can say, ear pinna plays a very important role in the determination of vertical sound mapping, where sound is coming from vertical direction. You can see in this, if sound is coming, there are two things. One is direct sound, second is reflected from pinna. If sound is coming from lower side, it will go like this, the direct sound, and indirect will be reflected and then go into the ear. Similarly, if sound is coming from upside, there is one direct sound and there is one reflected sound. So by interpreting the difference between the direct sound and the reflected sound, ear will judge that the sound is coming from up direction or down direction, means vertically up direction, upside or downside. Now next is our applied aspect, in which we will discuss deafness. What do you mean by deafness? Deafness is inability on a part of an individual to hear either wholly or partly. Inability to hear the sound either completely or partly. There are two types, conduction deafness and the nerve deafness. Conduction deafness and nerve deafness or sensorineural deafness. ठीक है, चलिए नेक्स्ट. कंडक्शन डेफनेस. कंडक्शन डेफनेस अकर्स ड्यू टू इंपेयरमेंट ऑफ ट्रांसमिशन ऑफ साउंड इन द कॉक्लिया. कंडक्शन डेफनेस अकर्स ड्यू टू देयर इज डिफेक्ट इन द कंडक्टिव पाथवे. कंडक्टिव पाथवे मीन्स व्हाट इज द कंडक्टिव पाथवे? कंडक्टिव पाथवे इज अवर एक्सटर्नल ऑडिटरी मीटर्स. Number two, our middle ear. So if there is impairment in external auditory meatus due to deposition of wax or any foreign body, or it may be due to injury of tympanic membrane or injury of ossicles, or due to any pathological fixation of stipes to oval window, that is called as osteosclerosis. So due to all these reasons, the deafness is called conduction deafness. Now next is nerve deafness. Nerve deafness is, as its name suggested, that it occurs due to impairment of cochlea or impairment of auditory nerve. That is why it is also called sensorineural deafness. So either cochlea or nerve is damaged. So in this, the person is permanently deaf. Now the causes are aging, then degenerative changes due to age. It may be hereditary. It may be due to drug toxicity. One drug is quinine and aminoglycosides, antibiotics, which causes this nerve deafness. Now any acoustic trauma, any vascular damage into the medulla. So these are the causes of nerve deafness. Now the test to determine differentiate between conduction of deafness and nerve deafness, as well as the hearing loss. Now what are the tests? The tests are, number one, watch test, very simple test. Second, tuning fork test. In the tuning fork test, we are having three: Rinne's test, Weber's test, and Schwaber's test. And lastly, highly equipped audiometry. So let us take one by one. Weber's test. In Weber's test, we place a vibrating tuning fork of 256 hertz frequency. We placed over the vertex of skull, and ask the patient to hear the sound. If person hears sound better in one ear or less in second ear, then it is called as lateralization. Means sound is lateralized to this ear, right ear. So lateralization is detected by Weber's test. Now next is Rinne's test. In the Rinne's test, we place vibrating tuning fork, the base of vibrating tuning fork, over mastoid process, behind the ear, mastoid process. We place the base of vibrating tuning fork over mastoid process and ask the person to hear the vibrations. And then first we do this. If person stops hearing the vibration, then we place same vibrating tuning fork in front of ear. The vibrating arms are now in front of ear. If person is able to hear the vibrations after completion of this, it means he is normal. So what is the definition of normal in this Rinne's test? If person hears a vibration after bone conduction is over, he is supposed to normal. This is the Rinne's test. Now Schwaber's test is this, that the bone conduction of subject is compared with the examiner's. Means you have to compare the vibration test with the examiner, with the doctor itself. And in this case, the doctor should be normal, or assumed should be, it is assumption that it is supposed to be normal. In conduction deafness, in the case of Schwaber's test, the patient hears the fork for longer period than the examiner, because in the conduction deafness, the patient is having better bone conduction, so he will hear the tuning fork for a longer period of time when he placed in on the base of tuning fork over the mastoid process. In the sensorineural difference, deafness, the examiner hears the tuning fork for a longer duration. In this case, examiner will hear for a longer duration than the patient. So in the clinical examination, usually we ask two tests, Rinne's test and Weber's test. I will show you both the testing in this screen. First I will draw the face. Suppose this is right side and this is left side. Suppose this is a person came to your clinic and asking for having problem in the or having difficulty in the hearing. First you do the Weber's test. What in the Weber's test, you vibrate tuning fork and place this tuning fork, vibrating tuning fork, over his vertex. Okay, so if lateralization takes place, suppose lateralization takes place in this direction, means person is having or hearing vibrations or hearing vibrations better in this ear in comparison to left side. In the right, he is hearing better in comparison to left side. So there are two possibility in this case. Number one possibility, that person is having conduction deafness in right side, in right ear. He is having conduction deafness in right ear because why we are assuming that? Because in the conduction deafness there is no air conduction. In normally air conduction, in normal person, air conduction masks the bone conduction, but in this case there is no air conduction, only bone conduction is there. So bone conduction is better in conduction deafness. So person feels better in this ear if he is having conduction deafness. Now what is the second possibility? In same condition, the second possibility is that the person is normal, having normal hearing in right side, but having sensory neural deafness, or you can say nerve deafness in left ear. So second possibility is nerve deafness in left ear. So two possibilities. Number one possibility, that he is having conduction deafness in right ear. So in that case, because conduction deafness increases the bone conduction, there is no air conduction, so bone conduction will be better. So person hear better in this ear, right side. In second possibility, there is, because he is hearing less in left side, so possibility it can occur that this person is having neural deafness in left ear and normal right ear. This is the second possibility. So how to confirm that these possibilities? Now for confirmation, we are having Rini's test. In the Rini's test, we vibrate the tuning fork and then we have to confirm these two findings. What are our findings? By Weber's test, our findings were, there may be a chance of CD, conduction deafness in right side, or neural deafness in the left side. This is right, this is left. So we have to confirm these two possible findings. So for confirmation, we use Rini's test. In the Rini's test, we place first vibrating tuning fork over mastoid process. The base of vibrating tuning fork we place over mastoid process and ask the patient to hear the vibration. Once the vibrations are over at mastoid process, we place tuning fork, the vibrating arms, in front of ear. In the after the vibration, after the patient hears the stops the hearing in this, then we place tuning fork in front of ear. If person is able to hear the sound, it means this ear is normal, because bone conduction is there, air conduction is there. If this ear is normal, then what will be the possibility? The possibility is he is having nerve deafness in left side. But if person is not able to hear the sound in second case, means first if you vibrate the tuning fork and place the base of tuning fork over mastoid process, he is able to hear the vibration. But once the vibrations are over at mastoid process, same tuning fork you place in front of ear, and if person is not able to hearing the sound in second one, it means he is having conduction deafness. He is having conduction deafness in this ear, in right side. It means there is first possibility, conduction in right side. If conduction deafness in right side, it means automatically the left ear is normal. This is the basis of Rinne's test, by which we can confirm the possibility detected from Weber's test. These two possibilities we have detected from Weber's test, and we confirm these possibility by doing Rinne's test. I think the entire picture of Rinne's and Weber's, or concept of Rinne's and Weber's, will be cleared to all of you students. So now we are coming to the next part, the last part, the test of audiometry. Audiometry, the nature of hearing disability is determined by the technique called audiometry. The instrument which we use is called audiometer. This audiometer is a generator, or generator of different frequencies, and it generates frequencies in the earphone, and subject is asked to wear the earphone. Now this instrument generates sound waves of different frequency as well as the loudness also. The intensity is set in the instrument at zero. Now while testing the patients, the loudness can be increased above zero level. At particular frequency, if the patient hears the sound with more than 30 decibels, above zero level, the person is said to having hearing loss of 30 decibel. Means zero is the normal amplitude of a particular frequency. If suppose we have to increase the amplitude from zero, it means that much amount of hearing loss is there in a person for that particular frequency. During the test by audiometer, the subject's ability to hear the sound with 8 to 10 different frequencies we are using, at different frequencies we check the decibel loss, the amplitude loss at every frequency. I will show you one graph also for that. In this graph, this is the normal. Normal means 0 decibel. So, and this is the testing of a patient at different frequency. These are the frequencies: 200, 500, 1000, 2000, 4000, 8000. At every frequency, we test the loudness at which decibel person is able to hear that frequency. So in this, you are hearing that these stars are bone conduction. The bone conduction of that person is almost nearer to the normal. This is normal and this is of subject. It is almost nearer to normal in bone conduction. And in air conduction, if you check the air conduction of that person by audiometry, you are seeing that there is significant loss. There is significant loss of amplitude or decibels or loudness in comparison to normal. It means this person is having conduction deafness. This person is having conduction deafness because his air conduction is lost, his bone conduction is normal. It means he is having conduction deafness, and the causes of conduction deafness already I have mentioned. And this is a audiogram of a old age person in which both the deafness are seen, conduction as well as the nerve deafness. So you will see both conduction as well as the nerve deafness are seen in this audiogram of this. In this particular frequency, there is loss of 20 decibels, both conduction as well as hearing. It means it is the case of nerve deafness, because both are decreasing, and nerve deafness may occur or can occur in old age person due to degenerative changes. Now lastly, tinnitus. Sometimes in Viva teacher can ask, what is tinnitus? Tinnitus is a ringing sensation. It is a ringing sensation, means like bells are ringing in the ear. It is ringing sensation in the ear by irritative stimulation, either internal ear or in the auditory nerve. This is called tinnitus. So student, we have completed the frequency discrimination by different theories, and then we have discussed in this lecture the applied aspect, different tests to determine the conduction deafness or to confirm the conduction deafness as well as the nerve deafness, and the audiometry. So with this, I have completed the hearing part under the heading of special sense. So very soon I am uploading other lectures, means from other system, in this channel. So please stay with us. Thank you very much.